In the poultry industry, we can identify two major groups of chicken breeds: the layers that are specialized in egg production and the broilers that are specialized for meat production. Among these different industries, there is also a sex preference. So only the female layers are required for the egg production because they are the only ones that can produce eggs. Whereas in the meat industry, only male broilers are preferred. So this not only adds a complexity about breed preparation for each of the different industries, but also there is a sex-specific preference among these breeds. One of the major problems the poultry industry has these days is that the chick is only determined after they hatch. So this means that the producers need to wait 21 days incubating the eggs until they hatch and they can determine if they are a male or a female by morphological structure. This results in half of all the hatchlings being culled or killed because they are of the unwanted sex, reaching a total number of 6 million chicks being culled per year. It's estimated that the egg industry could save over $2.5 billion a year if a solution to chick culling is found, making chick culling a major economic and animal welfare issue. Now, let's talk about something different. Let's talk about sex. Chromosomic sex is known to be determined at fertilization by the fusion of the gametes. In humans, we have X and Y sex chromosomes, but birds have Z and W sex chromosomes. Males having two Z chromosomes, where females have only one Z chromosome and one W chromosome. But although chromosomic sex is determined at fertilization, sex genes are active during early embryonic development, so when the chick is developing inside the egg. And one of the first processes where these sex genes have a role is in the process of gonad sex differentiation. Gonads have this extraordinary ability to differentiate into two completely different organs: the ovaries in the females and the testes in the males. And this process is initially controlled by genes located in the sex chromosomes. After the testes and the ovaries are differentiated, they start producing sex hormones that are going to impact and differentiate the rest of the body. So, understanding how the chicken gonad develops and differentiates is the first step to control the sex of the birds. Gonad contains different cell types, but one of the most important in the process of sex differentiation are the supporting cells. These cells are the first ones to differentiate into a male or a female phenotype in the gonad. And after they differentiate, they can control the differentiation of the rest of the gonadal cells into an ovarian or testicular phenotype. Most of the information we know about these cells came from mouse experiments. And as you can see here, the supporting cells in mice derive from the stellomic epithelium, this structure shown here in green. These cells ingress into the gonadal ridge and differentiate into supporting cells. It is thought that the supporting cell origin is conserved among vertebrates, and that's why we decide to study it in chickens. So as I mentioned before, the chickens develop inside the egg. This allows us to open a hole in the eggshell, and we can monitor chicken development, but also we can manipulate it. We express a green fluorescent protein in the stellomic epithelial cells, as you can see here, and after we perform this experiment, we seal the eggs and we let them develop until they were sexually different. Then we collected the gonads, and our main intention was to know if the supporting cells were derived from the stellomic epithelium. If they are, we are expected to see green staining in our supporting cells. Here you can see sections of the male or the female gonads where the supporting cells were stained in red, and the stellomic epithelial cells and their derivatives are stained in green. As you can see here, we found that there is no green expression in the red cells in both males and females. And this suggests that in chicken, the supporting cells do not derive from the stellomic epithelium. And this puts an end of this idea that supporting cell origin is conserved among vertebrates. So now we have a bigger problem. Where do these cells come from? And for this, we decide to take a step back and use a more exploratory approach. We use a technique called single-cell RNA sequencing that is kind of novel in the field, where it's based on the different cell types express different genes. We're able to isolate all the cells from the testes and the ovaries to generate a single-cell suspension. And using this technique, we're able to measure all the genes that are expressed on each of the different gonadal cells. This allows us to not only know the different cell types that are present in the gonad, but also to know which genes are being expressed in each of the different cells. Here I'm showing you the information or the results we have for the undifferentiated gonad, where each of these different dots, it's a single cell being sequenced. As I mentioned before, we also know the genes that are being expressed in each of the different cell types, and this helps us and gave us an idea of what the different cells are, and that's why they are color-coded differently. Here you can see an illustration of the previous figure, where you can see the different cell populations more easily. And now I want you to focus only in one cell population, the supporting cells. They are the cells I am interested in. After knowing which cells were the supporting cells, we can ask them which genes are being expressed in that cell population, and we are able to identify four different candidates: OSR1, PAX2, WNT4, and DMRT1. The next step we performed was to know where these cell types are located by looking at the different expression of these different marker genes. And as you can see here in purple, we can see the expression of the different genes, and we can see that they are not expressed in the cellulomic epithelial cells because they are in color white, but the purple staining or purple positive staining was present in these mesenchymal cells underneath the cellulomic epithelial cells. We can conclude that chicken supporting cells do not originate from the cellulomic epithelial cells as we showed before and as is known in mouse, but they originate from a mesenchymal population that express OSR1, WNT4, PAX2 and DMRT1, and this is the first time we identify where these cells are coming from. So this is just only a tip of the iceberg of the different results we obtain, and we're able to identify not only the origin, but also the different cell types present in the gonad, and how these cell types differentiate in the process of sex differentiation. This whole information was published early this year, and if you want to know more about this information, I suggest you to read this article or contact me by email or social media. We believe that this new information will be crucial to develop new tools to generate single-sex bird lines, and also to reduce the production cost and eradicate the chick culling process once for all. Thank you.